SpaceX launched a batch of 60 Starlink satellites to orbit on Monday, February 17th, marking its fifth overall launch of a group of 60 of the small spacecraft, and its third this year alone. This launch brings the total constellation to 300 satellites for Starlink on orbit, extending SpaceX's lead as the largest commercial satellite operator in the world. The SpaceX Starlink project sees the company deploying a constellation of small, low Earth orbit satellites that will work with one another in concert to deliver high-speed, low-cost broadband internet connectivity to users. The current goal is to launch enough satellites to begin providing service to customers in the US and Canada later this year, followed by eventual rollout of service globally pending further expansion of the constellation. Smoke billowed and flames erupted as the sooty Falcon 9 rocket roared to life at 11:05 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, lifting off from Space Launch Complex 40 at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station in Florida. The 229-foot or 70-meter tall rocket lifted off, powered by thrust from 9 kerosene-fueled Merlin 1D engines. The launch went off without a hitch following a 24-hour delay due to an issue with a valve component on the rocket's second stage. It was a foggy morning on the Space Coast, but the fog cleared just before liftoff. In this video, Engineering Today will discuss SpaceX's fifth batch of Starlink satellite launch mission, where SpaceX successfully launches 60 more Starlink satellites, but narrowly missed landing after fastest booster reuse yet. Let's get into details. The Falcon 9 quickly cleared lightning towers at Pad 40 and steered toward the northeast, sending a window-shaking roar across the Florida spaceport. 2.5 minutes into the mission, the Falcon 9's first stage booster shut down its engines and separated, allowing a single Merlin engine on the launcher's second stage to fire into orbit. While the second stage accelerated into orbit, the first stage of the Falcon 9 descended back through the atmosphere and attempted landing on SpaceX's football field-sized drone ship, Of Course I Still Love You, holding position nearly 400 miles northeast of Cape Canaveral. But following the successful launch, the rocket's first stage failed to land on SpaceX's drone ship landing platform in the Atlantic Ocean. If successful, it would have marked a major milestone for SpaceX, 50 booster recoveries. The Starlink mission was the 80th SpaceX launch, the company said. It's not yet clear what happened during Monday's attempted landing. On the broadcast, all that could be seen was a puff of smoke or steam to the side of the drone ship, indicating that the Falcon 9 booster missed the platform by a fairly wide margin. "We clearly did not make the landing this time," SpaceX Starlink engineer Lauren Lyons said. The rocket did make a soft landing in the ocean next to the drone ship, and SpaceX is optimistic that it landed intact, SpaceX representative said. The missed landing marked the first time a first-stage booster on a Falcon 9 rocket has missed a landing attempt on a SpaceX drone ship since 2016. To be sure, SpaceX has lost a few rocket boosters since then. The company's lost the center core of the three-core Falcon Heavy 2 out of 3 times in that rocket's first few launches. A Falcon 9 booster also missed the landing pad at Cape Canaveral in December 2018. Spiraling into the sea instead after a failure of one of the gridded fins that stabilizes its descent. SpaceX has also not attempted landings on about a dozen missions since that 2016 miss, something it usually does when the missions require the rocket to reach higher velocities that make landings more difficult. The rocket used on Monday's mission was a veteran of 3 previous launches and landings. It's not likely to be reused after landing in seawater. The booster, dubbed B-1056.4 by SpaceX, previously launched 2 commercial resupply missions, CRS-17 in May 2019 and CRS-18 that July 2019, followed by the massive telecommunications satellite JCSAT-18 Pacific 1 in December. Reusing rockets is a way to lower the massive cost of getting to space. Not only has SpaceX gotten really good at catching and reusing its rocket stages, but it's also doing it faster than ever. The rocket launched Monday was last used just 72 days ago, meaning the private spaceflight company, SpaceX, almost broke the record for fastest turnaround held by NASA's space shuttle. Two other SpaceX vessels were positioned in the Atlantic Ocean to try to catch the two halves of the Falcon 9's payload shroud. SpaceX did not announce the results of the fairing recovery attempt, but a SpaceX employee said engineers are still experimenting with catching the aerodynamic shroud using fast-moving ships fitted with giant nets. With each piece fetching roughly $3 million, SpaceX hopes to save some money by reusing them on future flights. To that end, SpaceX has equipped its fairings with an onboard navigation system that allows it to glide gently back to Earth. SpaceX has also outfitted two boats, Go Miss Tree and Go Miss Chief, with giant nets, like a mobile catcher's mitt, to snag the fairings as they fall back to Earth. To date, Go Miss Tree has made three successful catches. Go Miss Chief has yet to snag a fairing. Around the same time as the first stage reached the ocean, a SpaceX launch controller announced that the Falcon 9 upper stage had arrived in orbit and was poised to release the 60 SpaceX Starlink satellites, the mission's primary objective. The missed first stage landing could be attributed to a change in orbit for the satellites. For this launch, the satellites were inserted into an elliptical orbit, which required the rocket to work harder and made the landing more challenging than normal. A host on SpaceX webcast Monday said all future Starlink missions will use the new trajectory to input the satellites into an elliptical orbit after a single upper stage burn. "We are executing a direct inject of the Starlink satellites into an elliptical or oval-shaped orbit," said Jessica Anderson, a manufacturing engineer at SpaceX. "In prior Starlink missions, we deployed the satellites into a 290-kilometer, 180-mile circular orbit, which required two burns of the Merlin vacuum engine on the second stage. Keep in mind the stack of 60 Starlink satellites combined is one of the heaviest payloads we fly, so putting them directly into this orbit requires more vehicle performance and makes recovery more challenging," he said. Once checkouts are complete, the satellites will then use their onboard ion thrusters to move into their intended orbits at an operational altitude of 550 kilometers or 341 miles for operational service broadcasting signals in Ku band. As a result of the orbit change, the Falcon 9's second stage remained in orbit after releasing the SpaceX Starlink satellites on Monday. It's expected to passively re-enter the atmosphere in the coming months instead of performing a controlled deorbit burn as the stage did after previous Starlink launches. SpaceX has said its Starlink network will initially comprise 1,584 satellites, all operating in low Earth orbit. But the company is approved from the Federal Communications Commission to operate 12,000 satellites in Ku band, Ka band, and V band frequencies, with groups of spacecraft flying at different altitudes with various orbital tilts or inclinations, and plans to seek permission for up to 30,000 more, totaling 42,000 spacecraft. But SpaceX says the fleet's growth will hinge on demand, and the company must launch roughly 20 more missions before completing the first phase of its Starlink network. Elon Musk, SpaceX CEO and founder, has said the company will need at least 400 satellites in orbit to provide minimal coverage, and at least 800 to provide moderate coverage. With 300 now in orbit, that coverage could begin sometime this year. SpaceX's Starlink project aims to provide constant high-speed internet access to users around the world at an affordable price. But the company has not announced a price or internet speeds for its consumer-grade service. "Currently, we rely on wireless cell towers or cables routed into our homes and offices to access the internet. As a result, rural and remote areas are often left without access or have to pay high prices for the service. SpaceX aims to change that." SpaceX is also developing user terminals that will allow consumers to link with the SpaceX Starlink network from home, work, or even on the go. Additionally, the company has a contract with the U.S. military to demonstrate how the Starlink network's connectivity works aboard aircraft. But the rapid-fire deployment of SpaceX Starlink satellites has astronomers worried that the proliferation of small spacecraft could impact observations by ground-based telescopes. Since SpaceX's first 60-satellite Starlink launch, astronomers have voiced concerns that these satellites could interfere with crucial scientific observations. After the first launch last year, skywatchers noted that the tiny satellites are incredibly bright, even more so than the average satellite. That observation made scientists nervous about how the SpaceX Starlink constellation could interfere with their work. Radio astronomers also have concerns about the satellites and are planning for possible interference from SpaceX Starlink's radio-based antennas. Musk and SpaceX have been receptive to the complaints and said they'd look into reducing the brightness of the satellites. Last month, the company launched one satellite that was painted with an experimental black coating to make it appear darker in orbit. If this test goes well, future versions of the satellites could be coated in the same material, SpaceX has said. SpaceX is not the only aerospace company with plans of connecting the globe. OneWeb aims to build a constellation of 650 satellites. OneWeb has launched 40 satellites to date, with plans to launch roughly 32 to 36 more every month. It launched its first set of 6 satellites in 2019, and a second batch of 34 earlier this month. However, SpaceX has quickly amassed a sizable constellation due to its ability to launch its own rockets. Last week, the International Astronomical Union released a new warning about the potential impact posed by satellite megaconstellations on astronomy. That warning came after the launch of 34 OneWeb satellites on a Soyuz rocket earlier this month. The satellites owned by OneWeb are smaller than the Starlink spacecraft, and they orbit higher, allowing the company to provide global coverage with fewer satellites than SpaceX. The higher altitude also means they'll be dimmer to ground observers, the company says. "We're going to do the most we can to mitigate astronomers' concerns," said Adrian Streckel, OneWeb CEO. "We're not visible to the naked eye. We're visible to telescopes. It's hard to get around some of those facts." Scientists have also questioned whether constellations of thousands of satellites broadcasting broadband data will interfere with radio astronomy, which uses giant antennas to listen to faint radio signals generated from distant stars and galaxies. "With respect to radio frequency, we'll try," Streckel said earlier this month. "We're going to do the most we can. I don't know if there will be a solution that will make everybody happy. At least we're in dialogue, and we're trying to get feedback on what we can do." SpaceX's next launch is scheduled for 1:45 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, March 2nd. Again from Pad 40 at Cape Canaveral, when a Falcon 9 rocket will loft a Dragon cargo capsule into orbit on a resupply mission to the International Space Station. Another SpaceX Starlink launch on a Falcon 9 rocket is also scheduled for as soon as March 4th from nearby Pad 39 at Kennedy Space Center. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. And kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.